I love Mario Maker and Mario games, but sometimes when I play Mario Maker, I really wish that I was playing Pokemon instead. But whenever I play Pokemon, I suddenly want to play Mario Maker. That is a real problem. I believe that this is a problem without a solution. But since turn-based combat won the official Idea of the Year election, I finally decided to sit down and to try to solve this massive problem once and for all. Today we're going to take a look at two designs for turn-based Pokemon combat systems in Super Mario Maker. One system which features attacks that can crit and miss and follow the effectiveness table of the original Pokemon games, and one system where attacking is actually a turn-based combat without the need of attack minigames that features at least some sort of death and is one of the most complicated Mario Maker systems I've ever built. So you ready? Let's do this! Okay, so the first Pokemon battle is against the Wild Thwomp Dude. Mario attacks first. Our Plumbermon has the option to choose between four different attacks: a ground attack, an ice attack, a fire attack, and of course, a grass attack. The Thwomp Dude is obviously a stone type Pokemon, so ground attacks are very effective, ice hits normal, fire isn't effective, and grass is very effective as well. It looks like our Mariomon decided to use his ice attack first. Let's call the attack Blizzard. Each attack is represented by a small minigame, and depending on how good our Italian Champleon plays the minigame, the attack either misses, hits, or deals critical damage. This is represented by the exit pipes. The lowest pipe represents a miss, the one in the middle a hit, and the highest is a critical hit. It looks like this Blizzard is going to hit normal. Once the attack phase is over, our Plumber, who wants to become the best trainer in the world, finds himself in this screen. The blocks at the top right corner represent the Thwomp Dude's health. Once his health reaches zero, Mario wins the fight and is allowed to obtain the flagpole of this arena. Now the Thwomp Dude attacks. The stone Pokemon only has one attack. Mario needs to survive here until the timer runs out, and then he is transported back to the attack selection screen. Our Mariomon decides to attack once again using the ice attack. It looks like he didn't play much Pokemon as a child, otherwise he would know that using the ground attack against the stone type would be a better idea. Anyway, this time our mustached Pokemon manages to hit critical and deals 2 damage instead of only 1. Now the Thwomp Dude attacks once again. If our Plumber actually wants to become the best Pokemon trainer in the world, he really shouldn't lose this fight, but he has only 1 HP left and the Thwomp Dude won't miss him forever. Because of this, he now decides to use the grass attack. Let's call this attack Growth. Here, our Plumber can't deal damage, but he can grow in order to heal. This attack is once again a small minigame. He either gains a mushroom or a fire flower. Both heals him and makes him grow, but it also doesn't deal any damage. Okay, so let's fast forward a little bit. Next, our Mariomon decides to use the ground attack. Here he has to make his way upwards in order to hit. If he reaches the top, it is once again a crit. The first time he uses the ground attack, it fails, which means it deals no damage at all. The next time he uses this attack, he gets a standard hit, which means he should deal 1 damage, but since ground is very effective against Thwomp Dudes, the attack deals 2 damage. Next we use the fire attack. Here Mario has to ride the platform to the end in order to deal damage. Since fire isn't very effective against Thwomp Dudes, the attack either misses or deals 1 damage, but it will never crit. Next we use a ground attack once again, and this time the ground attack deals critical damage. This means that the attack deals not only 2 damage because it is critical, but 4 since it is very effective as well. This is enough to defeat the poor Thwomp Dude and allows our trainer, who wants to become the best plumber in the world, to finally touch his flagpole. Okay, so how does this design work? Well, it's actually surprisingly simple. We use the fact that shells only become loaded once they are no more than 4 blocks away of the current camera border. At the top there are 2 shells. One is always activated when Mario enters the room. The other one only becomes activated if Mario enters the room from the left, because otherwise it won't become loaded. We have 4 different damage numbers that Mario can potentially deal to the Thwomp Dude. 1 damage, 2 damage, 4 damage, or no damage. All that we need to do in order to get these different damage numbers in is to let Mario enter the room through different camera angles, because then a different amount of shells becomes loaded. This entry point is no damage, since the bullet blaster blocks the damage path and no shell is able to hit the Thwomp Dude. This pipe deals 1 damage because only 1 of the 2 damage shells become activated. If Mario enters the room through this pipe, however, 2 points of damage are dealt because both shells activate. The 4 damage system uses a super simple trick. We enter this room in a way that both shells are activated, then force Mario to wait for the bomb to explode and then re-enter the room again in a way that 2 shells deal damage again. 2 plus 2 is 4. Hooray! If you want to build such a design for one of your own stages, I'd highly recommend to only go for 2 or 3 different attacks. I actually want to randomize the form's attacks here, and I want to add a lot of other features to this design, but I ran out of transport pipes. Okay, so let's take a look at the second design. Here our Mariomon has to fight against the Beedly. Here he has to choose between 3 attacks, a standard attack that always hits for 1, a move that deals 0 damage but doubles his attack power, and a move that either misses, deals 1 damage, or crits and deals 2 damage. Okay, so before Mario attacks, just a quick question. If Mario was a Pokemon, which Pokemon would he be? I actually wrapped my head around this question before making this video, but I was unable to decide this. Would he be a Snorlax, a Drowsy, a Licky Licky? For other characters of the Mario universe, this question is so easy to answer. Bowser is obviously Emboar, Toad a Breloom, and Luigi a Zygarde in its complete form.
Thunder!
But I just can't decide what Mario would be. Maybe you wonderful people are able to help me out. Anyway, so Mario decides to use the standard attack first. This transports him to the attack screen. Here we have to wait until the attacks are loaded. The HP of the Beedly is once again shown in the top right corner. The standard attack deals 1 damage. Afterwards, the Beedly attacks. This Beedly actually has 2 different attacks, and its AI is programmed to choose one of the 2 by random. The first attack our Mariomon has to survive is flight. The Beedly flies high into the air and drops down afterwards and tries to hit our plumber this way. Once the defend phase is over, it is time for a plumbing trainer to attack again. This time he decides to take the attack which either hits, misses, or crits. It looks like the attack dealt exactly 1 point of damage. Not the best, but also not the worst outcome. Then the Beedly attacks again. But since we saw this attack already, we are easily able to avoid all damage here, and then it's attack time again. This time Mario decides to go for the saw blade move. This move is really interesting, as it does nothing on its own, since it deals no damage, but it makes the other 2 attacks significantly stronger for the rest of the fight. But that's not all. Since the attack buff is so significant, the attack was designed to only have a single power point, which means our Mariomon is only allowed to use it once per fight. We're going to skip the defense phase here, since the Beedly decided to use flight once again and re-enter the attack screen immediately. The Sawblade attack is now blocked, since there are no power points left for it. So our plumbing Pokemon has to choose between the 2 attacks left. The standard attack now deals 2 points of damage, since Mario doubled his attack stat. This time the Beedly uses the other attack. Here a Pokemoning plumber has to dodge the Beedly shell until a timer runs out, while he also has to avoid to take damage by the Beedlies which fly above him. Okay, so the buffed randomized attack is the last one to show off before we can take a look at how everything here works. This attack got buffed as well, and instead of 0, 1 or 2 damage, the attack now deals 1, 2 or 3 points of damage. This time the attack rolled only 1 damage. Now Mario only needs to attack one last time, which defeats the Beedly, grants him a key and allows him to finally leave the stage. Hooray! Okay, so how does this work? Well, it's actually surprisingly complicated. The whole design makes heavy use of the off-screen spawning rules, and it is really hard to explain because most of the stuff happens off-screen. Okay, so we have a couple of systems in place. We have a standard attack, which usually deals 1 damage, but which can be buffed to deal 2. We have a randomized attack, which usually deals 1 to 2 damage and can be buffed as well. And we have the buff attack, which is able to buff the other 2 attacks. All of this only works because we know at all times where the camera is going to be when Mario enters the room. Because of this, the room has 3 different entry points, which represent the 3 different attacks. Different things happen at different camera positions because of Mario Maker's really strange quantum loading properties. I'll explain all the different loading tricks in one of my upcoming videos in detail, but in order to understand how this design works, we need to quickly talk through a couple of tricks. So shells are only activated if they are no more than 4 blocks away of the current horizontal camera board order, but they load no matter of the vertical camera position. Node blocks are different. Their bounce part follows the exact same logic as shells, but they are only able to release their content if they are inside of the current vertical camera position, and then there are clown cars, which need to be inside the vertical camera in order to start to move, and have a really interesting code for horizontal activation, but that's a different story for a different video. We combine these tricks in a couple of interesting ways in order to get the attack system to work. The simplest example is probably the PowerPoint system for the saw blade attack. There is a bullet blaster that is spawn blocked here, and a small Schrödinger's node block contraption that only activates once on screen. This contraption destroys the brick block which is spawn blocking the bullet blaster, and because of this the blaster loads the second time this area is loaded. So we are able to deactivate this attack after one use by simply putting its entry door higher than the other attacks. Because of this the camera moves up, and the next time Mario is in this room, this attack will be locked. The skeleton roller coaster here basically acts as loading. We have to slow Mario down before he enters the next area, because the contraption at the top needs a second to do its thing. The next simple part of the contraption is the randomized attack. There are two simple clown car randomizers to the right here. These activate and either drop down none, one or two shells. The reason why this attack only activates when Mario uses the randomized attack entrance is because of a really interesting clown car trick. This clown car node block cannon bob omb setup only triggers if the contraption is on screen for a moment. If loaded, the bob omb goes boom and destroys the question block, which contains a vine. Question blocks containing vines always respawn, so this contraption is always blocked when the room is entered. But if the contraption is on screen, the question block becomes destroyed, and the random amount of shells that drop down are able to enter the actual damage pipeline and to deal damage to the poor Beetle. Okay, so the basic attack. This one on its own is simple as well. It's basically the same system we used in the previous Pokemon design. Here we enter the room at the bottom, which means all contraptions that only activate when on screen are deactivated. The room is built in such a way that the basic attack shells only activate when Mario is one block to the left of the room border. So only if Mario is in this area, the basic attack is triggered. And the only way to get this far to the left is by entering the room through the standard attack door. There is a one-way door hidden behind the door, in case you're wondering. Okay, so the basic attack only activates when loaded from the left, and the randomized attack only activates when loaded from the top. So far, so simple. The really cool thing here is how the attack boost system works. What we basically do when entering the attack room through the attack boost door is we load the left area and the top area at the same time, but we do not load the most right area. So the first thing that happens when entering the room at this position is that the clown car randomizer to the far right does not activate. Because of this, the randomized attack isn't triggered. Then there are some Schrödinger's node block shenanigans going on to the left here. These node blocks only release their content when inside the current camera border, which means they only activate when we enter the room through the attack boost door. These node blocks do two different things at once. First, they are set up in a way that they block the basic attack shell mats so that no damage is dealt when using the attack boost attack. Second, they despawn block these two shells. The bob omb only goes boom if on screen, but if he does, then these two shells are able to spawn every time from now on when the room is loaded. The shell in the top left corner now only spawns when we use the basic attack, and this is the reason why this attack now deals two damage instead of one. Hooray! The second shell is wired up to the randomizer attack. This shell is now basically added on top of the randomized attack, but only able to enter the main attack pipe if the clown car node block door was opened. This door only opens when we enter the room through the randomizer attack door, which means that instead of 0 to 2 damage, the attack now deals 0 to 2 damage plus 1 damage when loading, resulting in 1 to 3 damage. We buffed the second attack. Hooray! I'll admit that was a little bit complicated. Just one more small thing. Two block wide gaps are able to track how often a shell passed them for some super weird but useful reason. The first time a shell travels over a two block wide gap, it is able to pass it, but if the shell travels the same way back, it will drop into the hole. That is a really useful trick for wiring up systems like this one. Okay, so that's my take on Pokemon's turn turn-based combat. I uploaded both designs if you want to investigate how they work for yourself. You can find the IDs in the description. I actually wanted to have not one fight but two, and to implement a TM system between the fights, where Mario is allowed to learn one of two different attacks, which he can then use in the fight that follows. The funny thing is, these systems can be built. The only problem is that the item, door and space limitations in Mario Maker are so draconian that I wasn't able to fit all of this into a single stage. I think it is really fascinating that it is possible, in theory, to build such systems with Buzzy Beetles and Clown Cars. If we ever get a Mario Maker Switch with less limitations, that's one of the first things I'll try to pull off. Oh, and there's another thing. The lava is floor glitch sadly got patched, and because of this I'm not sure how to do the well-earned extra video for this design. I thought it would be fun to do another glitch showcase instead, but I kinda ran out of interesting Mario Maker glitches, so I thought I'd ask you for help. If anyone of you knows a Mario Maker glitch, feel free to leave me the ID to a level showcasing it. I'll showcase my favorite glitches in one of the upcoming videos. The next video will be a look back at Super Mario 64, as long as everything goes according to plan. With that being said, I hope you enjoyed this little video. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to leave me a thumbs up, and maybe you feel especially
Pikachu
today and wanted the subscribe button as well. I hope that you have a wonderful day, and to see you soon. Goodbye!